Lupin Pharmaceuticals in association with Higher Secondary Principals Forum.
Hello and welcome to today's biology class. I am Mrs. Rolita Judy Pierce, Grade 1 teacher at Rosary High Secondary School, Navelli. Before I begin today's class, let's take a look at one of the old saying that says, we do not inherit the earth from our ancestors, but we borrow it from our children. Yes, how true it is. We have borrowed this earth from our children. But have we behaved responsibly? What have we done to this earth? Let us take a look. This is a map of the Amazon. And as you can see, the green cover on the Amazon is the forest cover that was once there. The first picture shows as the turn of the century in 1900, you can see a vast expanse of green on the map. And as the time advances, when you come to the year 2000, you can see how this green cover has decreased. Thus, the Amazon has now turned Amaz off. This is the Great Barrier Reef of Australia, once a very productive ecosystem. Today, it stands bleached, as you can see the death of the corals. The increase in the global temperature, what we call as global warming, causes this bleaching of the coral reefs, which is the death of the algae, leading to a loss of a huge biodiversity. This is a before and after picture of mining in the Philippines. You can see the lush green mountains now reduced to a mere mound of clay with hardly any vegetation there. One of the most iconic buildings of our country, India, the Taj Mahal, once a pristine marble mausoleum, now stands tarnished due to air pollution. This is a slide very dear to my heart because it's in my neighborhood. I come from a coastal village and I have seen the erosion of the sand dunes. Once, these sand dunes were our natural line of defense against the rising sea level and even catastrophic events like the tsunami. But today, it stands eroded due to extensive sand mining, thus causing a huge loss of biodiversity. Well, this is what we have done to the earth. And this brings us to today's topic, which is environmental issues. Let us today take a look at all the different issues that our earth is facing. And to a great extent, we, the human beings, are responsible for these issues. Today, one of the major issues that the earth is facing is pollution. How do we define pollution? Pollution can be defined as any undesirable change in the physical, chemical, or biological characteristics of land, air, soil, or water. The different agents that cause pollution are called pollutants. There are various types of pollutions: air pollution, water pollution, soil pollution, land pollution. Today we will take a look at each of these in detail. The Government of India had passed the Environment Protection Act 1986 in order to protect the environment from such pollutants and also to improve the quality of our environment. Let us now take a look in detail at the different types of pollution, what are their causes, what are their effects, and how we can control them. Let us begin with air pollution and its control. We all need air, and if the air that we breathe is poisonous, you can imagine that life and survivability itself is threatened. The major causes of air pollution are the emissions from automobiles and from smokestacks from thermal power plants and smelters. These exhausts of automobiles and the smokestacks have got two main pollutants. One, the gaseous pollutants, and second, the particulate matter. The Central Pollution Control Board has defined particulates ranging from the size of 2.5 micrometers and less than that as harmful particulate matters, because we inhale them when we breathe in the air, and these settle in the lungs and cause an array of problems to human beings. Besides this, there are gaseous pollutants, oxides of sulfur, oxides of nitrogen, and oxides of carbon, which are present in the emissions, which are the pollutants in air. The effect of air pollution depends on two things. First, the concentration of the pollutant. What it means by that is how much of the pollutant is present in the air that we breathe. And the second is the duration of exposure. How long has an individual, an organism, been exposed to this pollutant? What are the effects of air pollution? Air pollution, especially the particulates, when we breathe in these particulates, they settle down in the alveoli or the air sacs of the lungs, and they can cause inflammation, which is like having pus in the alveoli, that can cause premature deaths in individuals. Besides this, they can cause irritation, chronic cough, and large-scale damage to the lungs. On vegetation, the plants are also affected by the pollution in the air. Mostly oxides of sulfur and nitrogen can cause premature death of plants. It can cause in leaf drop, that is reduction in the foliage, premature death. Problems like necrosis and chlorosis are also seen in plants. In human beings, besides the lungs being affected drastically, there are other effects of oxides of sulfur and nitrogen, which could be eye irritation, irritational cough, and bronchitis. In nature, we see phenomena such as acid rain that takes place. When oxides of sulfur and nitrogen react with rainwater, harmful sulfuric acid and nitric acid comes down as acid rain and affects life itself. Air pollution is also responsible for greenhouse effect. In the later part of this lecture, we are going to discuss in great detail about the greenhouse effect. But just to mention, greenhouse effect is a phenomenon that causes warming up of the earth. And if the pollutants are increased in the atmosphere, the temperature of the earth will also increase, causing global warming. What are the solutions to air pollution? There are a lot of solutions that have been mentioned. Let us look at one at a time. The first solution is some devices. We are going to take a look at three different devices that can be used to reduce the effect of pollutants as they are released from the exhaust of smokestacks and automobiles. The first device that we are taking is an electrostatic precipitator. An electrostatic precipitator is a device that has got highly charged electrodes at several thousand volts. These electrodes emit electrons which are negatively charged. There are also plates which are grounded, and air is passed through the electrode first and then over these grounded plates. The air that is coming in is dirty air, that is, it has got a lot of particulate matter. As the air with the particulates moves across the highly charged electrodes, the particulate matter gets the negative charged. And as it moves along the grounded plates attract the charged particles. Thus, the air that leaves the plate is free from particulate matter. This technique can be effectively done to remove the particulates from exhaust, and the air that is passing over the grounded plates has to be at slow velocity so as to allow time for the particulates to settle down. The next device is called as a scrubber. The scrubber is a device that can be fitted into smokestacks in order to remove the poisonous gas like sulfur dioxide. A scrubber will have a thin film of water or lime that is constantly sprayed and agitated. As the air containing obnoxious gases passes through this stream of water, sulfur dioxide will be removed, and thus the exhaust will have less amount of poisonous gases. Another device that can be used to reduce the pollutants from automobiles is called as a catalytic converter. A catalytic converter is made up of catalysts including very expensive metals such as platinum, palladium and rhodium, which act as catalyst to bring about the conversion of unburnt hydrocarbons to carbon dioxide and water, carbon monoxide, which is highly poisonous, to less dangerous carbon dioxide, and nitric oxide to nitrogen. A catalytic converter is fitted in the automobile, and such an automobile has to use unleaded petrol, because if lead is present in the petrol, the lead could inactivate the catalyst. Besides this, we have strict laws in place, legislations in place, which are aiming at reducing the quantity of aromatic hydrocarbons and sulfur in the exhaust of automobiles. And our aim is to reduce the levels of sulfur and aromatic hydrocarbons to around 50 parts per million and 35% respectively by the year 2000. Let us now look at a case study of the city of Delhi. Delhi, the capital of India. Today, it is nicknamed as the choke capital or the asthma capital of our country. If you see, in 2014, as per a report and a study done of 45 most polluted cities of the world, Delhi ranked at number 4. In 2016, the World Health Organization released a report that Delhi had overtaken Beijing in China and became the most polluted city in the world. If you compare this data given by the World Health Organization, if you look at the first graph, you can see here that Delhi is the most polluted city of our country, India, and in comparison to the world also, we are number one. That is, Delhi became the most polluted city in the world, overtaking Beijing and other countries at pollution levels. Now, what does it mean for a common man? For a common man, living in Delhi and breathing the polluted air is like smoking 20 cigarettes a day. It is said that if you are breathing the air constantly on the roads of Delhi, it is like being in the gas chambers of Adolf Hitler. Today, the acceptable level of particulate matter of 10 micrometers is 60. Delhi shows an alarming 283 level. Particulate matter, the more harmful ones, of 2.5 micrometers, the acceptable level is 100, and Delhi is above the danger mark, that is 517. So if you see, the situation seems very grim in the city of Delhi, and recent reports on air pollution say that by 2050, 6 million people will die per year due to air pollution. Not just that, another study says that in the city of Delhi, 44% of the school children have reduced lung function. Now, what are the causes for such high levels of pollution in the city? One is the automobiles. Delhi alone has got so many automobiles that if we put together the total number of vehicles in the state of Gujarat and West Bengal, it would amount to the vehicular traffic on the roads of Delhi. Delhi also has many coal-based power plants, high or huge amount of construction activities. They used to have open burning of solid waste and industrial garbage dumps, which have all contributed to this high level of pollution in the city of Delhi. What are the solutions? What did Delhi do to take care of this problem of air pollution? There was a public interest litigation that was filed in the Honorable Supreme Court of India, and the then government of Delhi was directed to take actions to improve the quality of air in the city of Delhi. What did Delhi do? Let us see point by point what Delhi did to control air pollution in the city. First, Delhi began to change their public transport fuel from petrol and diesel to compressed natural gas, what we call as CNG. Compressed natural gas is the gas that is obtained from natural oil wells, and it is compressed at very high pressure, 25 megapascals in high pressure containers, and methane is the chief constituent of compressed natural gas. All the buses in Delhi, the public transport systems, began to use CNG. What are the advantages of CNG? CNG is better than petrol and diesel because it is cheaper than petrol and diesel, first. Second, it burns almost completely. That means it has very low emissions. It is not going to produce a lot of gaseous pollutants. It cannot be siphoned off by thieves, and it also cannot be adulterated. Due to these merits of compressed natural gas, it was widely used in the city of Delhi, and this brought down the pollution levels due to automobiles drastically. And one of the disadvantages of using compressed natural gas is that it is difficult in laying down the pipelines for a delivery system of compressed natural gas. In fact, in the state of Goa, we too have one of the petrol pumps which is also having a CNG pump with it, but it is not very popular here because not all the stations have the facility to deliver compressed natural gas. But we are looking at it as a solution in the future to bring down the vehicular pollution. The next thing what Delhi did was they followed stringent laws prescribed by the auto fuel policy. According to the auto fuel policy, the government of India laid out a roadmap to cut down the vehicular pollution by the vehicles on the roads. And these norms were aimed at reducing sulfur and aromatic hydrocarbons. The norms of the Bharat Stage 2 norms of vehicles was in keeping with the Euro 2 standards, which were to reduce the sulfur to around 50 parts per million and aromatic hydrocarbons to around 35 parts per million. Today, the Euro 3 norms are implemented in the country, and the metropolitan cities which have more number of vehicles have to follow the Euro 4 norms. What does it mean? It means that cars have to have better engines. The vehicles on the road have to have upgraded engines so that the fuel they use should be burnt completely with very less emissions. Here is a table that you can refer to later for all the values as per the Euro 3 and the Euro 4 norms. Besides this, what else did Delhi do? They phased out all old vehicles. Older the vehicle, more the pollution. So they phased out the old vehicles. They began using unleaded petrol in addition to compressed natural gas. And they started also using better quality of petrol, which had lower levels of sulfur in the petrol and diesel. They started fitting catalytic converters and making them mandatory for vehicles in the city of Delhi. They applied stringent pollution level norms for vehicles, and they followed the auto fuel policy that was prescribed by the government of India. All these drastically reduced the air pollution in the city of Delhi. Now, the Air Prevention and Control Act of 1981 was amended in 1987, and noise was included as one of the pollutant. What is noise? Noise is any undesirable high level of sound. And what are the sources of noise? The sources of noise could be musical instruments, loudspeakers, crackers, industries, etc. What are the effects of noise? In human beings, it can cause psychological and physiological disorders. The acceptable decibel level for human ear is around 85 decibels. But a loud sound, a sudden loud sound such as that given by the taking off of a jet plane, which is like around 150 decibels, can cause the rupture of the eardrum and cause hearing impairment. Not just loud noises, but chronic exposure to relatively lower levels of noise can damage the hearing abilities. It can cause sleeplessness, increased heartbeat, and breathing problems in human beings. How can we control noise pollution? If there is any industry or an establishment that has a lot of noise due to heavy machinery, etc., such areas can use sound absorbing materials so that the sound can be absorbed and the noise pollution can be drastically reduced. We can have delimitation of horn-free zones, especially around hospitals, old age homes, schools, where the noise is not acceptable. We can have no horn zones. Besides that, we can prescribe permissible sound levels for firecrackers and loudspeakers so that we can control noise pollution. And we can also have timings so that we can restrict the use of loudspeakers. For example, Goa has a sound restriction timing of 10 p.m., after which a particular level of decibels of sound cannot be used over the public addressal systems, and such laws help a lot to control noise pollution. What can you and I do? We have talked a lot about air pollution, but what is our responsibility? How can you help? How can I help? First thing what we can do, these are just a few suggestions that I can give you. The rest you have to think for yourself. Plant a tree. A tree is known to absorb the carbon dioxide and convert it into oxygen. A tree that has been living for 40 years is known to absorb around 40-year-old tree can absorb around 1 ton of carbon dioxide. Plant a tree. Save the environment and air pollution. You can also switch to eco-friendly modes of transport. Avoid using your two-wheeler, in the sense of one that is run by petrol or diesel. Instead, cycle, walk. Besides, young people like you should also be involved in campaigns where the vehicles on the road should be conscientized against loud sounds honking on the road so that noise pollution can also be reduced. These are just some of the measures that I'm suggesting to you. You can think of your own novel solutions to make the air that we breathe much cleaner. Let us move now to the next pollutant, that is water pollution. Water, the elixir of life. We all need water. We live in a country where we venerate our rivers and water bodies on one hand and pollute them on the other. Water pollution is very, very dangerous for survival itself. If we look at the water resources of the world, they are highly polluted. The two main causes of pollution in water are domestic sewage and industrial effluents. A mere 0.1% of impurities in sewage make it unfit for human use. Now, what are these impurities in domestic sewage? Domestic sewage could have suspended materials like silt, clay, sand. Colloidal materials, which could include human excreta, it could be bacteria, paper, cloth, fibers, and it could have dissolved materials, nutrients such as nitrates, phosphates, calcium, sodium, etc. When this sewage gets into a water body without proper treatment, that water body could be rendered unfit for human use. One of the measure that can tell us about the level of pollution in a water body is by estimating the BOD, or what is called as the biological oxygen demand of a water body. Now, in any water body, there are aerobic microbes. When organic matter is available, like for example, if sewage is disposed of in that water body, it has a lot of organic matter like human excreta. The aerobic microbes will immediately get into action and they will use up oxygen from the water and start the biodegradation of this organic matter. And in doing so, they will rob the water body of precious oxygen. Let us take a look at this graph. In the graph, you can see that this is the direction of flow of water, and this is the point at which sewage is discharged in the water body. The red graph line clearly shows a dip, or the oxygen level of the water is really low. Dissolved oxygen is really low because the microbes, the aerobic microbes, have used the oxygen for biodegradation of this organic matter that was present in the sewage. Now, if we would test the biological oxygen demand of such a water body at this point where sewage is discharged into that water body, the level of BOD would be very high. We would get a very high BOD reading, which tells us that the water is highly polluted. Whereas in the same water body, if you take the BOD at a different level, at a upstream level where the sewage is not discharged, at a relatively cleaner point of the river, we would have low levels of BOD, telling us that the dissolved oxygen is high, and that means the pollution here is low. So BOD is a direct measure of pollution. Higher the BOD, higher the pollution of that water body. Very often we see such a phenomenon happening in water bodies. You can see some white or green colors come over the water body, and this water body usually will emit some foul smell. You may also see some dead organisms in water bodies such as these. This is a phenomenon that is called as an algal bloom. The presence of more nutrients in a water body, which come from draining from a nearby human activities like using of chemicals, pesticides, insecticides, fertilizers of chemical nature, they all run off into water bodies and enrich the water body. When this happens, the water body that is enriched starts showing algal blooms. The algae in that water body start growing very rapidly and forming a green layer over that water body. Now, when such a thing happens, then the toxin level of that water body drastically goes high, because some of the algae that are found in these algal blooms are highly toxic. They also rob the water body of precious oxygen, thus causing harm to the other living beings of that place. And you can also find other organisms that can grow very quickly in this kind of waters. These waters are said to be showing the phenomenon of eutrophication. One common organism that you see growing in the waters, even in Goa, is a plant like this. This is water hyacinth or Iconia. This plant was introduced in our country. It's an alien species in the native place, and it has beautiful mauve color flowers. This is a weed, and this has very high reproduction rate. In fact, if you manually try to remove it, its reproduction ability is much higher than the removal ability of this water body. As a result, this weed can grow at a very high speed in eutrophic waters, and it can choke the water body. It can draw out all the nutrients, it can draw out all the oxygen, and the lower level flora and fauna could be choked to death. And we can see that the water hyacinth will almost finish off that water body, and in later stages it can even convert into land. Once a water body can slowly move towards converting itself into a land phase. Now, if we look at other wastes that have been discharged into the water body are wastes coming from hospitals and sewage from homes. Hospital waste can contain blood, they can contain tissues and other materials that come out from the hospitals. They could also have some chemicals in them. If they are dumped directly into a water body, then what can happen is it can lead to the damage of the water body, and it can cause diseases such as dysentery, typhoid, cholera, jaundice to human beings. Industrial wastewater contains toxic substances such as DDT, heavy metals like mercury, cadmium, copper, lead, etc. And it can also have a lot of organic compounds which can enter the food chain. Now, the level at which an organism feeds is called the trophic level of that particular organism. Now, when the organism feeds, it takes in this poisonous substance, say for example a pesticide or say a heavy metal, and it accumulates it in the body because body has no mechanism of metabolizing this substance. As a result, there is a accumulation called as bioaccumulation of this material in the body of that organism. Now, when this organism is fed upon by the next trophic level, this poisonous substance is transferred to the next trophic level. And in doing so, the poisonous material keeps on transferring to the higher and higher trophic level. And as it moves to the higher trophic level, it also gets magnified, what we call as biomagnification. So, we can take this example of biomagnification of DDT in a water body. DDT is a pesticide that is used in agriculture. When it gets into the water body, the zooplankton start bioaccumulating it in the body. The zooplankton are fed upon by fishes, small fishes, so it gets transferred to the next trophic level. So, it began at around 0.003 parts per million in the plankton, and by the time it reached the next trophic level, it increased, it got magnified to 0.04 parts per million. Then these small fishes were fed upon by larger fishes, and the larger fish, in them if you test the level of DDT, it became to around 2 parts per million. And when piscivorous birds began to consume this fish in the highest trophic level, that is at the level of this carnivorous bird, we found that the level of DDT magnified to around 5 parts per million. This DDT started interfering with calcium metabolism of these birds. As a result, the eggs laid by this bird had very thin shells, because shells in eggs of birds have got calcium. And when the birds had no proper calcium, the eggs produced by them started having a very brittle shell which could break prematurely, and this drastically brought down the population of the birds due to bioaccumulation and biomagnification. Now, as I was telling you about algal blooms leads to a phenomenon called as eutrophication. The word eutrophication in Greek means well nourished. When a water body starts getting nourished, that is addition of additives such as nitrates, phosphates, sulfates, etc., due to human activities such as rampant use of fertilizers, pesticides and other chemicals used in agriculture, washing, etc., the nutrient level of a water body increases. As a result, the algae and other plants that are found there begin to increase. So, we start with algal blooms. Slowly, other organisms like water hyacinth, which is also nicknamed as the terror of Bengal, they start growing and they cause a slow death of this water body. And this phenomenon is called as eutrophication. Slowly, the water body becomes from a cooler water body to a warmer water body, and cold water organisms get replaced with warm water organisms. The depth of the pond also starts decreasing considerably, and ultimately the water turns unfit for life, and this water body can convert into land, as I told you earlier. Now, this is a phenomenon that occurs and takes maybe thousands of years. But sometimes, if the water body is located very close to human activities, then this process of conversion of a clean water body into a eutrophic water body and ultimately to land can be accelerated, and this can be called as cultured or cultural or accelerated eutrophication. What happens is, you can see here in the diagram, this is a clean water body and this is the sediment content of that water body. But due to human activities, suppose the water body gets enriched, then such a water body will become warm and the life here will be replaced, the life forms will be replaced, cooler water forms will be replaced with warmer water forms, marsh plants will inhabit, weeds will inhabit, and it will choke this water body, and when they die, they add to the sediment of that water body and drastically reduce the depth of the pond, and thus slowly the water goes on declining and ultimately this water body can turn to land. Such a phenomenon due to human activity, which take place over a few years as compared to thousands of years as occurs naturally, is called as cultural eutrophication. And this eutrophication can be mainly contributed by additives such as nitrogen, nitrates, phosphates, sulfates from human activities. One example of a eutrophic lake in India, there are several of them, the Dal Lake in Kashmir, the lake in Orissa, as well as the Ulsoor Lake in Bengaluru is highly eutrophic. If you can see here, the fish are found floating on the water surface because they have died. They have died of choking because there is no oxygen available in the Ulsoor Lake due to eutrophication, causing a lot of loss of biodiversity. I have shared the link on my slide. You can also refer to it later if you would like to know more about the Ulsoor Lake and its eutrophication. What about Goa? In Goa also, we have a lake, the Miramar Lake, which is very close to the Santines Creek. Now, the Santines Creek is highly polluted due to human activities and it carries a lot of effluents into the Miramar Lake. And the Miramar Lake is slowly dying a death which needs to be stopped. If we stop our activities and stop releasing the nutrients into the Santines Creek, then the health of the Miramar Lake will improve because the feeder creek, that is the Santines Creek, takes lot of impurities to the Miramar Lake and causes eutrophication of this lake, and we can now see that the water level of the lake is drastically coming down and it is moving towards cultured eutrophication. Now, we also have one more type of pollution related to water, and that is heated or thermal wastewater pollution. Whenever industries such as paper industry or hydrothermal industry, they use water as coolants, and this water, when it is heated up, it has to be discharged. Now, the establishments do not take proper care, and water with high temperature is just released into the nearby water bodies. Now, what this does to the water body is it increases the natural temperature of that water body. And when there is an increase in the temperature of the water body, the flora and fauna that are used to a particular level of temperature get drastically affected. There could be some organisms who are stenothermal, that is, they cannot tolerate high levels of fluctuation in temperature. They will be drastically affected, and this life can be lost forever due to continued thermal water or heated water from industries being released into the aquatic water bodies. We now have a case study of the Arcata marsh in northern coast of California. Now, this is an example how the townspeople and biologists from the Humboldt State University created an integrated wastewater treatment program for the Arcata marsh, which was once heavily polluted with even heavy metals, and there was very less biodiversity found there. But due to the efforts of these townspeople and the biologists from the Humboldt State University, the Arcata marsh, which was almost dying, is now a place for recreation because it has got very high level of biodiversity. And let us look at how they solved this problem. Now, this is an overview of the various marshes that are found in this region of Arcata. Now, what happens is when wastewater is released, it is first treated by primary treatment. In this primary treatment, the wastewater will be taken to the first series of ponds where the water will be allowed to sediment so that all the heavy objects and materials like silt, clay and other things can settle down, and this can be filtered out, and the water is now released to next level for further treatment. Now, the next level is a series of six connected ponds, and these ponds are supposed to remove the dissolved materials from the wastewater. Now, the dissolved materials are much difficult to remove. The physical materials which are floating, and they can be removed by physical processes, but dissolved materials are not easy to remove. But this method of using this six series of ponds is a very effective method of removing dissolved substances, even heavy metals like mercury, cadmium, copper, etc. Now, these series of six ponds basically consists of certain types of plants like algae, which can assimilate or they can absorb the heavy metals and use them in a way for themselves. One of the most common plant used in this six pond is the hard stem bulrush. This is a plant which can take up mercury, cadmium, and it can use it in a productive way for itself. And in doing so, what it does is it removes the impurity, the dissolved impurity from the water. Once this is done, the water is now removed of the floating debris. It is also removed of the dissolved material, and now the water can be sent to enhancement marshes, before which it is chlorinated and dechlorinated. Then it is stored in these enhancement marshes, and the water which was once poisonous is now a useful resource that can be used by the community. Now, this whole project is regulated by a group of citizens called as the Friends of the Arcata Marsh, who have done a wonderful job and have left a beautiful example for us to follow how using natural processes we can tackle water pollution. Today, the Arcata Marsh is a house to a vast diversity of life, birds, clams, oysters, otters, different types of plants, and people visit this place for recreation because it is a biodiversity hotspot which has got so many different varieties of living beings. Now, one more solution that we can look at is the solution that is coming from EcoSand toilets. Now, basically, when human beings use the toilet facility, a lot of water is used, and this water is just running down the drain and getting wasted. But now we are coming to a very eco-friendly solution to this problem, to conserve water and also to avoid the fecal matter from getting into water bodies. And this solution is by EcoSand toilets, which are very popular in the state of Kerala and in a country like Sri Lanka, and very soon they are going to be a reality in the state of Goa as well. Now, what is the basic idea? The EcoSand toilet does not flush out the waste, but it converts it into something very useful. For that, let us understand the construction of an EcoSand toilet. An eco sand toilet consists of two toilets in series. At a time, only one of the toilet will be used. Now, this toilet has got two outlets, one for urine and one for the feces. The urine will be stored in a container which will be processed, and then the urine can be used for agricultural activity as a very valuable fertilizer. The fecal matter will be sent to a compost pit where it will be allowed to compost and convert into manure. Besides this, the water used for washing also can be drained out and can be used for irrigation purpose. So, the compost pit which has the solid fecal matter is allowed to degrade and then get converted into manure. When one of the toilet is filled up, because I told you that it is a series of two toilets, when one of it is filled up, the use of this particular one is discontinued and the other one can be used. By the time this first one, the manure will be ready, which can be removed and used for farming activities. So the user will use maybe minimal amount of water, but the urine and the fecal matter that is obtained from this toilet can be treated using living organisms, and the waste can be converted into useful manure that can be used for agricultural purposes. The water used for washing can also be used for irrigation for agricultural activities. By doing this, by using EcoSand toilets, we can save thousands and thousands of liters of water, one. The second advantage is that the sewage will not have harmful human excreta. In fact, the human excreta can be used as organic manure, and thus even reducing the pollution that can be caused by chemical fertilizers. So we need more sustainable solutions such as this, like the EcoSand toilet. The Government of India has passed the Water Prevention and Control Act of 1974 in order to safeguard our water resources. We have spoken a lot about water pollution. What can you do? What is your role to protect our waters? Each one has to make a difference. This is a time for you to think and reflect, what can you do to conserve water first and to avoid polluting our water bodies? I have just shared a link here with you of an organization in the city of Ponda, which is an organization called as SAVI, that is Study and Awareness of Wildlife Environment, which is an organization which takes up time to time cleaning of mangroves and other water bodies and reducing water pollution. You can read about it, and you may also get some idea as a group, as a class, as a club, what you can do to save the water bodies of your surrounding. Let us move to the next, that is waste and their effects. Here we are going to talk about solid waste. Solid waste is becoming a huge problem. In common words, we are going to look at the problem of garbage. What are its causes? What are its consequences? And how we are going to solve this problem? Well, solid waste refers to everything that goes out into your trash bin. You go to the market and you shop, and when you come back, what useful thing is there, you remove out, and the rest, everything goes into the trash bin. All this waste accounts for solid waste. Now let us look at what happens to your trash bin. You may conveniently just throw it into your bin, but where does all this waste from your trash bin go, and how are we generating such large quantities of solid waste? Take a look at this slide. If you decide to go and buy a shirt, what you pay for is just one shirt. But along with that, look at the packaging. Look at all the things that you get along with the shirt. Are you going to use all of these things? Definitely not. What you are going to take from here is just the shirt. And the rest of the packaging material, right from the polythene bag to the box to the tag and the other plastic material that comes along with the shirt, will go to your trash bin. Where does it go from the trash bin? Well, all the waste from the trash bin goes to what are called as sanitary landfill sites. A sanitary landfill site is a pit that is dug into the ground and all the solid waste is dumped into this landfill. But the problem here is that we are generating solid waste at a very high rate. So much of solid waste is generated that the landfill sites are overflowing. And then we have even people just dumping it on the side of the road at different nooks and corners, isolated places. And it is really a pitiful sight to watch as you travel around and you look at the surroundings. You get a stench from the garbage that is dumped. The pollution level is very high due to this solid waste just without treatment when they are dumped into landfills or on the roadsides. If you look at a very famous landfill site in South Goa, it is overflowing with waste. And all the waste is mixed together. There is no segregation. Anything and everything is put into your trash bin. It is collected and it is dumped into a sanitary landfill site. The sanitary landfill site that is present in South Goa is overflowing. It burns at times, emanating poisonous gases. And even more poisonous is this dark color liquid called as leachate, which seeps out of this garbage that is dumped in the landfill site. If you see, there will be a dark colored black liquid called as leachate. It is a concoction of various poisonous substances. This leachate sinks into the groundwater and contaminates the groundwater. And pollution of groundwater is a huge threat to life because we consume this groundwater, and if it is contaminated with such poisonous substances, then life itself is really threatened. This is a picture that I took in my neighborhood. I live in a coastal village in South Goa, and this picture is taken in August 2020. August 2020, this was the site. All the trash that was dumped into the sea at different places in South Goa washed ashore at my beach. And this was a very pitiful sight to see that all the waste was collected on the beach and then a hole was dug and everything went into that hole. You can imagine what might be the state of the ground level over there. The pollution that is caused in the water first, affecting the marine life, and now even the beach is polluted. Who is responsible for this? What can we do about it? Let us look at this in a little more detail. Now, solid waste are of three types. First, we have the biodegradable waste, which can just undergo natural breakdown with the help of microbes, and it can be converted into something useful. All your vegetable peels, fruit peels, and food material can be converted into useful manure, and this waste is called biodegradable waste. Then we have the non-biodegradable waste, something that cannot break down by the natural process, like we have plastic bags, poly bags, polystyrene, etc. And third, we have a class called as recyclable material. Recyclable material could be paper, plastic, electronic waste, what we call as e-waste, etc. Now, what can we do? This is the whole waste that we are faced with. Of course, the biodegradable waste can be treated. We can dig a hole and we can use microorganisms to biodegrade this waste and convert it into manure. The non-biodegradable waste can be segregated as recyclable and non-recyclable. The recyclable waste like plastic, paper, cloth, etc. can be used to make useful object. And just the non-recyclable material, which is very little, can be taken to the sanitary landfill site, thus reducing pressure on a sanitary landfill site. What can we do? We can go, I showed you the example of the shirt where you had so many different packaging material. Instead, we can go for eco-friendly packaging like this. Simple packaging which uses recyclable material, and thus we can reduce the pollution. We can use measures like carry your own shopping bag. We have been hearing this for a very long time. But this small effort by you and me can save the environment from a lot of solid waste pollution. We can recycle our waste, we can segregate our waste at the source, and we can also undertake activities which can help in cleaning our surrounding. As a class, as a group of friends, as a club, etc., it is our responsibility to take care of our surroundings and to avoid solid waste pollution. In solid waste, we also have hospital waste. Hospital waste having bandages, parts of tissues and organs, blood stained materials, etc. These materials can have harmful microorganisms, and these harmful microorganisms can get into water bodies, they can get into the soil, they can get into the food chain, and they can ultimately reach the living beings and cause harmful effects like serious diseases. Besides this, they can also cause direct harm to plants, vegetation and animals that are living in the waters, that are present in the soil, etc. Now, what can we do about hospital waste? Hospital waste need to be incinerated. The incinerator is a device which uses very high temperature and burns this solid waste. This is one of the measures that we can take for dealing with solid waste coming from the hospitals. Now, with this, we can just summarize the three types of pollutions that we have dealt with today, that is air pollution, water pollution, and part of solid waste and its management.
Prudent Scholars, powered by Lupin Pharmaceuticals.
अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में. लूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर, आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस. अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में. लूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर, आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस. अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में. लूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर, आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस.